Welcome back. You're watching HFO-TV. HFO-TV is co-sponsored by J.R. Johnson, LLC, specialists in multifamily restoration and repair work, Gantry Incorporated, the nation's largest independent mortgage banking firm, Butler Exchange Group, offering 1031 tax-free exchange services, and Forensic Building Consultants, experts in the diagnosis, repair, and preservation of multifamily assets.
Welcome back to HFO-TV. I'm Greg Frick, partner at HFO Investment Real Estate. And today with us, we're lucky to have Eric Cress, Principal of Urban Development Partners. How are you doing, Eric?
Great.
Good.
Thank you
good.
For having me. It's good to be here.
Yeah,
good
definitely.
To see you, Greg.
So I've known Eric for years. You've California, you've came up, if I remember, it's the Bay Area. Maybe give some background, kind of your background, and then we'll talk a little bit about what it's been like developing in Portland, what's kind of changed since you've been up here. This market's seen a lot of growth, a lot of changes, and I'd love to get your take on it, as you guys have done a lot of urban development, mixed use from multifamily to some office, and great to just, have the audience kind of get a take of what you're seeing and maybe some predictions for the future.
Yeah, we moved up here in 2006, April, so what's that, about 16 years ago. And I remember it was in an April, it was like a dry season in Portland. It was easy to sell my wife. We were from Berkeley, California, California weather, just had our first son. She looked at me and said, okay, I'll move up there with you, but you got to tell my mom that you're moving her first grandchild up to Portland. Yeah. So we came up, saw a lot of opportunity. I mean, it was difficult in 2000, this is 2006, right. Pre-GFC.
And you guys were doing stuff, not just ground up development then. I mean, we involved in some of the stuff you bought, some acquisition, reposition plays as well. So
yeah. Adaptive reuse, rehab, different right. things like that. We came up here. Saw a lot of opportunity. We felt like there was an underproduction of housing in Portland. Right. Had conversations with elected officials about that. At the time, it didn't look like it. I mean, you saw condos going up, cranes everywhere, but very little apartment production.
Right.
And in fact, some apartments that were being converted over to condos. That looked like a need that needed to be filled. So we came up and at that time and started prospecting.
With the idea of getting into more development of multifamily and mixed use.
Yep, absolutely, absolutely.
Was it, at that point, was it looked at easier to develop up here as a, we've heard the stories about San Francisco and Berkeley. Was it, it's gonna be a little, more opportunity in terms of, opportunity because of land and all that, but also from a legislative and bureaucratic side, did it feel easier than what you were experiencing down south?
Oh yeah, no question. When I was in graduate school, I was in a real estate program at Berkeley, and all you talked about or studied was the affordability of housing, how it's hurting the economy, how there's low production down there. It took 2 years to get anything entitled. It was expensive. There was a lot of regulation over it, but still huge affordability issues.
Right.
Came to Portland. It looked like it might head that direction because of the production, but it was easy to get things entitled. We couldn't believe it. We thought people were joking. 6 months to get a permit right. for a multifamily project, that really reduces the cost, really reduces the risk. That pre-development risk is the most difficult to raise equity for, to get right. financing for, to get through that period. It was much easier here.
And is that slow? Now we're hearing stories about how that's kind of changed, and just, again, we've had a lot of construction, we've gone through, when you guys have come up, then we had the crash and it's kind of come back, and 10, 11, we really boomed up and we've had a lot of cranes up. What are you seeing differently now, or how are you looking at opportunities? Are you looking at other markets now? Is this kind of feel like what San Francisco was when you came up here 10 years? So does that force you and your capital to go to other spots to find opportunity?
Yeah, I'd say we're probably 10, 15 years behind. If you want to see what Portland's going to be, you can look at the 4 year, the 5 year entitlement periods of San Francisco if we kind of keep down this route, which is, it's a lot of deja vu. It's following a lot of the path that San Francisco and the Bay Area did, which made it really frustrating because, as you can imagine, you work on a project, you have one kid, you have a new kid, one's going off to college before you get before you get maybe three done.
Right.
That pace is tough. So up here it's faster, but it's slowed down. It has slowed down a lot. No question. You hear about it. We're feeling those growing pains, feeling the affordability issues here.
Right.
And a lot of it is production problems.
And then I know we passed inclusionary zoning here for on the development side, and kind of changed. There was a multi-program before where we've talked about before, it was more of a of a carrot as opposed to a stick on the affordability side. How is that? Has that changed how you guys are looking at projects, or you know, maybe kind of shine some light about, you know, kind of the nuances of those programs?
Yeah, you know, inclusionary housing type of issues, which I'm actually a proponent of inclusionary housing in general.
Right.
I mean, there are a lot of benefits. You have diversity in terms of socioeconomics. You're getting cohorts of people into the core, and access to education, employment, all those things are really important. The issue is how you fund that inclusionary housing. So when you employ kind of a prescriptive inclusionary zoning that essentially requires developers to put those into the units, that's okay, but you have to understand that the burden for that lies on the renters. Right. On rental housing, because it increases the cost of the rental housing, and that's a fundamental equity issue, right? If you're funding your affordable housing through renters but not the rest of the population, it doesn't make a lot of sense, and over time it increases the average cost of housing, the cost of living within the region. So that's problematic. There are discretionary programs that you know, kind of automatically calibrate. There are other ways to solve this issue. I mean, what Nobel Prize for Economics was awarded a few years ago down at Stanford for doing auction theory around these types of programs, so where they automatically calibrate using free markets to make sure that cities, and I can understand it, politicians, elected officials don't want to be seen as paying too much or putting money into developers' pockets or private market pockets. But by creating some competition around that, using some auction theory, they can alleviate a lot of that problem and increase production. Anyway, getting into the weeds here.
Which is kind of, you know, which is, again, when you're putting in programs like in place that are going to reduce production, you know, added cost, the end result, you may not see it in day one, day two, but you're going to see it down the road. And again, does that end up kind of doing the exact opposite of what you're looking for in terms of trying to create the affordability?
Yeah, I mean, if you think about it, it's just, there's a thought problem. Imagine if you produced, you know, more housing, you know, let's say you produce 10% more housing for every individual within a region.
Right.
You know, you really had an aggressive housing policy. As you know, you're not going to let a building stay empty. You're going to drop your rents and fill that unit. Rent control causes a problem with that because it creates sticky pricing, and
exactly,
that's a whole economics area. So people won't drop because there's a restriction on raising.
Right.
But take that out of the equation. You produce enough housing, there will be a drop in the pricing because you can't afford to hold a vacant building.
Right. Yeah. And so I try to explain to people, the developers don't set the rents. I mean, we may put it on a pro forma, you may talk about it, but it's got to be the market-driven rents as to where if demand's not there, you're going to have to make an adjustment. So when they talk about, you know, rents are, we used to get conversations, all this money came from California and it drove rents up. Like, no, that didn't drive the rents, that's the demand. The money that's coming in investing, they just can't arbitrarily say, I want to charge this much for rent. If the demand's not there, it's not going to fill. So you either get the option of lower your rents or, you know, keep it vacant, and we know they're going to lower the rents. So there's like a disconnect sometimes.
There is, exactly. I mean, first of all, developers maybe own 1% to 2% of the entire housing inventory.
Exactly.
They're working on the margin, so they're not really.
They're not driving the market.
There's a tiny yeah, piece, and if the production of new housing is increasing the price of rents, then just use Jacoby's rule and invert and say, okay, let's just demo that new housing, and those rents should go down then.
Right.
Of course, that's not going to happen. If we demo a bunch of new buildings, their rents are not going to go down.
Right.
So it does defy logic.
Yes. So as a developer, I'm sure that's frustrating as you're trying to explain, you know, how you're trying to get this. And it's an interesting perception of what, you know, people that aren't involved in the industry and how they look at it and how they're going to put, you know, regulations or rules and thinking that what it's addressing. But at the end of the day, you know, I know you've been involved in a lot of committees. Are they asking your opinion on this? Are you feeling like this is getting through, or, you know, kind of?
They do. I mean, they do ask our opinion. I think our elected officials' hands are tied to a degree because they have to answer to their constituents. There's a lot of confusion among the public around housing production. I mean, even around the terms. I mean, like you mentioned earlier, developers, people get confused between what's a developer, what's a landlord, you know, developer production, landlord holds the assets, you got contractors building the assets, they got property management managing the assets, and all that gets conflated together, and they have trouble sorting those out.
Right.
So it's easy just to
kind of group it all together.
Right, yeah,
right.
And that's problematic.
Yeah. So I know you guys have also done some mixed use office. What's that market like? kind of pre-COVID, post-COVID from your standpoint? Are you looking for developments in that arena? Is office changing? I mean, we hear a lot of stories about it. Our audience is mostly multifamily, but there is some mixed-use stuff. What's your kind of take on that?
Yeah, I mean, office is tough right now, just because it's foggy. We don't know. No one really knows.
Right.
People have tried to predict, and honestly, I thought that the picture would be clearer now, but with these continued variants and how the virus has progressed, we still don't know. Suburban office is faring pretty well. Mm-hmm. We have a project in downtown Beaverton that we've been working on. That's an office project near the Round. By the way, Beaverton's has been a wonderful city to work with. Their staff is really kind of gets it. So we feel good about, you know, some of the suburban towns, but in the core in Portland, it's quiet.
Yeah. So on the office side, and like you said, in Beaverton, are you having to change? I mean, are requirements going down? Are you looking at tenants that are because of, is it hybrid? Is it not? Or is it too early for that to shake out as you're looking at possible leasing? And
I think it's early. Yeah. You know, we look at real estate long term. So trying to figure out where are we going to land long term? I mean, people will certainly come back to the office, but the question is, what is the utilization rate and how are they going to use that office? And is this, what's a trend? What's not a trend? I mean, we've learned a lot about trends just over the last couple of years, whether it's Peloton or Clubhouse or any other type of app or
And I say, you know, retail was going through a transition anyway. I think COVID just kind of fast-tracked some of that transition for some of these companies. And, you know, I think in the officing will be very interesting because we were kind of going to a co-work space environment, but, you know, maybe I'm not in the office every day, I'm going to co-work. Well, now with the variant, the virus, is that really still going to be, you know, then it's how much space do we need? So how that all shakes out is going to be interesting.
It's really hard to say. I mean, remote workers may want to go into a co-working location and not go into the home office. They don't want to commute. That becomes available to them. If you're a young urban worker working in a metro area, you probably don't. It's pretty expensive to have a separate office in your home.
Right.
And plus, they want to get in front of the boss and build relationships for them. I think it's going to be really important that they get in the office. Other people, you know, I mean, certainly if you're in certain industries, being in front face to face is not as important.
And on the apartment side, are you looking? With that in mind, are you designing units a little different? That's always kind of the question that, you know, developers and builders take a lot of risk because you're looking, planning, it's the length of, you know, so long to get there. You're kind of thinking, where do I think I'm going to be? What do I think I need to design? How do you kind of process that with all these changes that we've had the last couple of years?
Yeah, it depends a lot on the market. You asked earlier if we're developing in other markets, and we have projects in Washington, like Oswego downtown. I'm really excited about our project here. As I mentioned, Beaverton, California and Sacramento and Berkeley and in Salt Lake City, Utah. Each of those markets is different, so the programming is different. I mean, if you're in the urban core, you might like to build a bigger unit that would facilitate that type of work, but it's so expensive per square foot to build that it's risky to kind of jump into that quite yet.
So then are you still pushing for a nice common areas within the apartments and community areas? And though the last couple of years has been tough as we haven't really been able to utilize them, but you know, that may be where you can offset maybe the lack of square footage.
I think so. And I think we'll come out of that. Yeah. I think we will get through this.
No, I know. Oh yeah. Well, and historically we've always gone to metro area. I mean, it's just population. That's what's going to happen. So
yeah.
What other, so you're Washington, Salt Lake, is it tough to get in other markets like that? I mean, how do you guys as a group kind of find those, and you know, what's a way to get inroads in? Because, you know, like you said, you had to meet with elected officials when you came here. Do you have to do that same process in each city, or how does that work?
We do, to a degree. I mean, it's easier. Some areas are easier than others. We usually start with an economic analysis. We work with Rosen Consulting Group down in the Bay Area. They do consulting for, you know, major funds and REITs and whatnot. So we've had them work through and help us identify metro areas that we can get to easily within a quick flight and back, because we want to be on the ground, boots on the ground in those areas. A lot of these metros are really, frankly, inviting. They like the type of work that we do. We've had invitations from elected officials in some of these metros to come out, do some of the type of buildings that you do. I mean, I know you're familiar with some of our work.
It's very nice, yeah.
And we're conscientious about, you know, artfully designed buildings. We consider the built environment as part of the environment that you see, you know, that you're out in, that you're looking at, that we consider a lot of stakeholders. So I think that drives a lot of that desire from some other
municipalities. Okay.
Yeah, to bring us in.
Now, and we've heard a lot within, you know, the portal is, you know, shortage of, you know, with builders and trying to get, you know, just employees and, you know, workforce shortages. Are you seeing that on your other, is it, you know, I know it's not unique, but is it more severe in one market versus another? Or is, I mean, kind of, I guess you've got experience now in different markets, kind of the differences between a, you know, Portland and a Salt Lake or, you know, San Francisco and some of the nuances on the development side.
It's really hard everywhere.
Yeah.
Yeah. Construction costs are something that you're dealing with everywhere.
Yeah.
Labor issues, all of those. Haven't really seen it. I mean, markets that are deeper might be a little better. You know, if you're working in a smaller town, like, you know, let's say like Boise, which might have, you know, three major contractors that do vertical multifamily development. There's just less contractors to go to.
Go off, yeah.
Yeah, so yeah. that can be problematic and more problematic in times like these. But it's pretty universal. What's interesting is the timing changes. So we might be working on a project up in Spokane, and they're saying lumber's up there, but it's not here. And then the vice versa. So
really?
that's kind of hard to figure out, you know,
right.
How those markets are changing in different markets. How your raw materials.
Have you had to do anything different on the raw material side, like on lumber? Are you, you know, pre-ordering it early, trying to lock in your contracts early? I've had stories of developers that are, you know, they've ordered the appliances and just stored them somewhere. So they're so afraid that once they're ready to go, if they had to delay, they didn't want to delay, you know, occupancy. Are you doing things like that to kind of offset some of the supply chain issues?
Yeah, you need predictability because you're locking in your debt, you're locking in your equity, trying to bring more money to the project. You can do it, but it's painful,
right.
You know?
Right.
So a certainty once you close on the loan, close on your GMP, your construction contract. You want certainty from that standpoint. So that often means you need to pre-order and lock in a lot of pricing early. It's always a gamble. Like, well, it might go down,
right.
And it might. But at that point, certainty is really
certainty
a priority.
Certainty is your friend at that point. So
yeah, and if you think it might go down, probably the best thing is just to delay the construction start as opposed to get started without, you know,
right.
Without that certainty.
Right. Interesting. Well, thank you for taking the time to kind of show some insight on kind of what the development world is. You guys do very good projects. For people that aren't familiar, you can go to the website and see some of the various projects Eric's been involved in. It's been a pleasure kind of getting to know you guys more and, you know, wish you much success here in the near future.
Absolutely. Thank you, Greg.
Thank you.
I appreciate it.
We'll see you next time on HFO-TV.
Our entire office specializes in multifamily real estate, making HFO the largest multifamily brokerage in the Pacific Northwest. Your success is our passion. Build your legacy with HFO. Call 503-241-5541 or visit our website at hfore.com for more information.